All right, so hi everyone. My name is Raj Rajshekar. I work as a developer evangelist for Microsoft. Welcome to the session. Thanks for coming. So in this, over the next 30 minutes, I'm going to quickly spend some time talking about, it's not audible. I'm not sure. This is our max. So in this session this morning, I'll maybe talk about some of the concerns that we have as web developers, you know, for building web apps and work everywhere. Right? So maybe if I ask you a question as to what is the single biggest pain point while developing web applications and websites, what would you say?
I6, I7.
Yeah, so that's basically the biggest main point. So we want to use maybe I'll just talk really loud. So yeah, I mean that becomes the biggest pain point, right? Like you want to use the new capabilities that HTML5 brings to the table, CSS3, ECMAScript 5. And then, you know, the fact that clients have been told that all that's great, but, you know, this has to work on 96, this has to work on 97, and, you know, it has to have, you know, super perfect fidelity across all these different browsers, you know, browser brands, browser versions. So this talk is about what some of the best practices are, some of the things that we can do to make sure that our app, you know, works acceptably well across, you know, different browsers. So that briefly is the agenda. So just to kind of see what are the challenges today for working with different HTML5, some modern technologies, right? What are the challenges working with that? And then we'll take a look at a JavaScript library called as Modernizer that helps us deal with this problem to some extent. There's a small little message that I want to deliver with regard to CSS3 vendor prefixes. We'll talk about polyfills and shims. If you haven't heard of them, you know, I know that probably sounds like a very, you know, complicated thing, but it's not. It's a very simple concept. And then we'll look, as we go along, we'll try to review some best practices around HTML5. So with that, let's quickly get started. So that, you know, really is the problem, right? The fact that there are so many browsers. As an end user, probably this is a great thing. We are just spoiled for choices, right? I mean, we want to use the web, and, you know, we have all these different browsers. All of them do a great job of rendering the web for us. It's a great experience as end users, that's great. But as web devs, probably not so great. The fact that, you know, all of these browsers don't do everything exactly the same way, right? There's just a little bit that's different. And part of that, you know, the blame for part of that needs to go to the W3C itself. Turns out, you know, before the HTML5 suite of specifications, before that was formulated, there was, you know, the specifications were not as precise as they might have been. You know, some of the implementation aspects were left to browser vendors. You know, some of them were ambiguous, so browser vendors could make their own interpretations of what, you know, a particular spec meant, and they would just go ahead and do it. And, you know, what that resulted in was each browser did a particular thing in a different way, and then we had to kind of work around those issues. With HTML5, you know, for example, that's something that that's been fixed, or an attempt has been made to fix that. HTML5, you know, the typical markup spec is over 1,000 pages. You know, they have tried to go into excruciating detail about each individual aspect of the spec. You know, all these browsers are there. Not only do we have to worry about different brands of browsers, we have to worry about different versions of browsers, right? So it's not just, you know, supporting IE, Firefox, Chrome, Safari, Opera, and so on. It's also about specific versions of those browsers, right? So, and, you know, IE6 just doesn't go away, right? I mean, it's been there for such a long time, and can we just completely ignore it? You know, maybe there are scenarios where we can, maybe there are scenarios where we can't. The fact is, it's not completely gone away. So if you have to, you know, kind of deal with this issue, one of the ways you could do is you could write your apps to, in fact, this is what traditionally we've been doing, right? We write our apps to keep track of the browser. So in our code, we write, is the browser, you look at navigator.user agent, and then we try to, you know, do some sniffing to figure out what browser it is, and then we try to write our code appropriately, right? So if you have to do that, what you're essentially doing is you're taking upon yourself the responsibility of keeping track of what browsers have what features and how they've been implemented. And given that we have at least three browsers that you probably want to target, i.e. Chrome and Firefox, and given that all of these have so many different versions and all of those versions have different implementations, that's a task for a superhero. That's not something that you probably know. This is a little pie chart that shows the browser market share as of March 2012 from netmarketshare.com. Regardless of who has what percentage, as web devs, there's actually one takeaway, right? Can we look at this picture and say that, okay, so if I support browser blah, I'm done. Do you think you can say that against the picture? You can't, right? I mean, so i8 has about 25%, i9 has about 15%, and Chrome and Firefox. So it looks like, you know, at least these guys you probably want to handle. So different browsers, different versions of each browser, and you know, another thing that has been happening recently is that the cadence of browser releases has increased as well, right? How frequently do new versions ship? Now that's something that Google has kind of set a precedence for. Google Chrome started shipping like at a tremendous pace, and it happens transparent to the end user, right? The end user doesn't even know. Like, I don't even know what version of Chrome I'm running right now. It's probably 17 or 18. And Firefox has started shipping at a greater cadence as well. Even Microsoft has started increasing the speed, right? So i9 shipped March of 2011, and then a year later we have platform preview 5 of i10. It's out there. So new versions are getting released. So again, you know, just more stuff that we have to think about in hand. So this is something that we've been doing, right? We've been doing browser detection. So we've been trying to write code which says, is the browser this particular brand, and is it this particular version, then I write a particular kind of code. That means that you have to essentially, you know, track feature support. This is the sort of thing that can make grown men cry. So what is the alternative, right? This is, what will work is basically if you can do feature detection as opposed to browser sniffing. Right. Don't try to write code that looks something like that. So for example, here's a little bit of code that's trying to attach an event handler to the Windows load event. So there is a little bit of code. How many of you have written code like this? Navigator or user agent index of some substring and then you write some code. How many of you have done that? Don't be shy. I've done that. this works, right? And we used it because it worked. Now the problem with doing something like this is, here we are making assumptions about features based on the browser brand, right? So we are taking Microsoft's job of keeping track of which browser has what feature and so on. And you can I can tell you it's not an easy job at all. It's not something that we should be doing either. The problem with this is, add event listener is the W3C way of adding an event handler for a particular event, right? Attach event is Microsoft IE proprietary. So you don't want to do proprietary things if you can help it. And this is deprecated. So newer versions of IE will not have, it is there right now, but you can, you know, it's a deprecated API, it might go away at any time. So you want to do add event listener whenever you can. So this particular code checks if you are IE. If you're not IE, then it goes and says add event listener, otherwise it calls attach event. The problem with this is, with IE9, add event listener is now available, right? So i9 and i10 support add event listener. So this is probably a better alternative. So here we say if window.addEventListener is available. So here we're basically sniffing for the existence of a particular property on a particular object. So we're saying if the window object has a method called addEventListener, then I go ahead and use that. Otherwise I check if attach event is there and I do that, right? So the benefit here is I really don't care what the browser is, right? All I'm looking for is whether the feature I'm looking for is available in that browser or not. And if it is there, then I use it. So this, you know, might not seem like a major deal, but this is called as feature detection. And here, when browsers, you know, get better and better, your code just automatically goes in the correct path or the preferred path. So briefly, make decisions based on features, not browser versions. You know, you can check for specific object, method, property, or behavior. And another thing that this allows you to do is, if you detect that a particular feature that your web app requires is not available, then you get to go ahead and, you might want to load up a polyfill, basically another library that supplements that particular browser with that functionality. Let's say you have a site which needs Canvas support, right? And you know, you can do this feature detection to find out if the current environment supports Canvas. If not, maybe you will load a polyfill, maybe something like a Canvas Flash based or Silverlight based implementation of Canvas, you can supplant your pages. So you get to do some intelligent things with your code when you do feature detection. But the caveat is, there's a little demo I have here, not much of a demo. In fact, I'll probably skip that. It's basically essentially the same code that I showed you earlier. Let me just show you the code here. So it's essentially the same thing. So I say window.add event listener, then I say add event listener, and I attach a handler for that, and I basically show a different message. If it's attach event, then I say you're not using standards compliant API, otherwise you are. I go ahead and click this little link. It says you're using a standards compliant browser, because basically here it's checking for that add event listener, right? If it's available, then it works. I use F12 debugging tools to change my document mode to IE7 mode. So this is a feature in IE where you can hit F12 to launch the debugging tool, and you can go over there and you can change the browser rendering mode. So by default it will be IE10 rendering mode, this is IE10. And you can change it to IE7, 5, I think 9, 8. So all of these modes are available. So as soon as you switch it, then the browser will pretend like this is IE7, right? So if I go ahead and click this thing now, you can see that it went into the other case where it goes the else case and does attach event instead of add event listener, and that's not available. So your site just works, right? Whichever is the most acceptable code path, it follows that. Now that's great, but what if feature detection look like this, right? In the earlier case, I was just checking for add event listener, and I could simply say window.add event listener, and I'm all set. But what if it looks something like that, right? That's where Modernizer comes to the rescue. So Modernizer is this JavaScript library that allows you to deal with this whole problem of feature detection in a very elegant fashion. That gigantic piece of code that you saw was code to detect whether the current browser supports CSS3 font face. Right? So CSS3 has this feature called font face, which allows you to use custom typefaces. So that code was to detect whether the browser supports that or not. Modernizer is a library. It's open source, available, posted on GitHub, which allows you to do feature detection in a very simple kind of code. So you can, for example, let me show that code, what that looks like. So that's what, that big piece of code that you saw there, that's what it looks like when you're using Modernizer. You just include a script SRC in the top of your HTML, and then you get to write code like that. So there is a global object called Modernizer that you introduce into your script, and then you're able to do Boolean checks like this for various kinds of properties. For example, I want to check if Canvas is supported. I say modernizer.canvas, then I go to that. Otherwise, I do the alternate thing. And this makes you, here again, you'll notice that I'm not doing browser sniffing at all, right? I don't care what the browser is. All I'm checking for is whether the current client has the support for the feature that I am looking for. So Modernizer detects all major HTML5, CSS3 features, it does a pretty nifty thing. For example, if you want to check if the browser supports the video tag, HTML5 video, so you can say modernizer.video. Now you can go one step more and you can find out what codec does the client support, right? If it is IE, then it supports H.264, it's Chrome, it supports maybe WebM, and so on, right? So you can even detect that. So it tries to do that. For example, with input types, with form types, right? Does this browser support the HTML5 form type, like email, URL, and so on? So you can check that. So you can check whether this particular client supports input type email, right? And then you can write code to do that. Or you can put fallback, which will do the script validation. So that's what Modernizer brings to the table. It's gaining quite traction. For example, Microsoft Modernizer is being shipped to Visual Studio. So when you're creating ASP.NET MEC projects, Modernizer gets included automatically. Another thing that Modernizer does is it adds support for older browsers, for IE 6, 7, and 8, which don't support the HTML5 semantic tags. So let's say you want to, for various reasons, you want to use semantic tags in your markup, right? So you don't want to just your HTML being just a soup of divs, right? So that's not something that you want to do. You want to use header, you want to use section, you want to use aside, figure, footer, article, and so on. So the problem with using these new tags is that IE 6, 7, and 8, they don't know what to do with that. Right? So basically just ignore the tag and just render the text inside of the tag. What that means is you would have specified CSS, right, to style your markup. So if you have a header and a section article, you have styled it in CSS. IE 6 and 8 just ignores it. Right? So basically your page looks sad. So what Modernizer will do, there's a little hack that you can put, a little script that you can put to make IE 6 and 8 recognize these tags. Basically, if you just say document.createElementOfHeader, and you don't even have to do anything with that, as soon as you write a statement, that tag becomes magically recognizable in IE 6 and 8. The hack itself doesn't matter. When you include Modernizer, it gives you support for the semantic tags in IE 6 and 8. So that's a little extra bonus that you get. So let me show you what that looks like. So I have a page here. Wow, the resolution is really slow, really low. So that's the page, not much. I don't know how clear this is. But basically here, I have a few divs here, not divs, I have header, section, and so on. You can see that there's a little border radius, there's a little drop shadow. Let me show you the source for this. So, any standard page that you might use when you're using semantic tags. I have a header, I have section, header, and inside the section I have a header and the h1. Here I have p and so on, right? So again, I use F12 to change the mode. So right now it's rendering in standards mode, which is IE10's mode. I'll change this to, let's say, Internet Explorer 7. Or in fact, before that, let me go and change that code a little bit. I'll go ahead and load this here. So you can see right at the top, I included a little script here. Script src equals modernizer 1.7. This is, I had put together this thing some time back. So actually now the modernizer version is, I think, 2.2 or something. So feel free to get the latest version. So I've included this JS right at the top, and then the markup works as usual. So what I'll do is I'll go ahead and comment this thing out. And then we go and refresh this. So this is an IE10 mode, so it looks fine. So I go ahead and change this to IE7, and then that's what that page looks like. Clearly that doesn't look very nice at all. So essentially what has happened is in IE7 mode, it just ignores all the new tags, header, section, article, and so on. It just renders the P inside it, it renders the H1, and so on, but the rest of the stuff it just ignores. And when I say ignore, it means that the CSS rules are not getting applied. Right, none of the CSS styling is getting applied. So let's see what happens when I just go and include modernizer. And then I go and hit F5. You can see that this looks more or less similar to what we had in the IE10 case, right? There are some differences. I don't get border radius, I don't get shadow, but that's fine. In fact, that's another thing that we can probably pass along, is that web designers have this compulsion to provide pixel perfect fidelity across all browsers, right? So I have a border radius, I have a shadow for all these elements. It has to look exactly the same way in IE 6, 7, and 8, right? Now, I'm here to tell you that it doesn't happen. So if people are on IE 6, 7, and 8, they don't get to see the box shadow, that's fine. You know what? I mean, they'll never see it, right? They don't even know that it's there, right? So they're not going to be seeing it, they're not going to complain. Whereas you would be putting so much effort to get that thing to come up, right? I mean, it's possible to make it work here, but it's probably not worth the effort. Or if your client comes and tells you that, I absolutely have to make this work in 6 and 8, add one more line item here, double your job. because you will be working much harder to make it work in older browsers, right? So it's okay to not be pixel perfect across all browsers. Newer browsers, automatically the experience is richer, older browsers, not so rich. But you know, stuff like Modernizer gives you an acceptable experience UX. So this is not too terrible. So that's Modernizer. So this is another kind of a small appeal that I wanted to kind of make to the web development community with regard to CSS3 vendor prefixes. How many of you here know about or don't know about CSS3 vendor prefixes? Okay, we have a few folks. So CSS3 brings a whole new set of presentation capabilities, right? So for example, the box shadow and the border radius, CSS3 transitions, 2D transforms, 3D transforms. So all of these are capabilities that CSS3 brings to the table. And all modern browsers have started implementing and the support is available. However, these specs are not final yet, right? So these are still, it's still a working draft, right? It's not a proposed recommendation yet. W3C has this whole sequence of states that specifications have to traverse through, right? It's a first public working draft, and it becomes a working draft, and then it becomes a candidate recommendation. Proposed recommendation can. So basically this whole process flow is there, and it typically takes on the order of years for it to transition through these things. So why is this happening? The W3C committee wants feedback, like real world implementation feedback. So how they get that is browser vendors implement these things in their browsers, in their production retail browsers. And then, since they are not final yet, which means they can still change, how do you put that in the browser, right? So as soon as I implement something in the browser, or in any product for that matter, I have to support that forever, right? So if I go and support feature A, and that's the thing about pushing something through the door, right? As soon as it goes out through the door, that's it. If there's a bug there, you're screwed, because you have to support that all through the lifetime of that product, right? So that's the same thing here. So if I go and implement a feature which is not a final standard yet, and the standard changes, how do we deal with this whole problem? So with CSS3, what happens is you can write vendor, you can prefix your CSS rules with some code like that. For example, if I want to do, if I want to apply an animation to a particular CSS3 element, so I can say --ms-animation, and I can provide the rule, right? So WebKit is basically for Chrome and Safari. So I can say --webkit- a particular rule colon value, and for Firefox is --moz-, right? So this is pretty popular, right? Everybody does this. And then the W3C version of that particular rule will be without a prefix, obviously. So if it's a border radius, it will be just border radius, and it won't be with any prefix. Now the problem that I see in the industry is that folks are supporting WebKit, right? So everybody wants to put WebKit, and it works perfectly fine in Chrome and Safari. Firefox, IE, Opera, even if they support that particular vendor prefix version of that particular spec, they still do not see it, because the developer has to use only --webkit- in their CSS. In fact, there are plenty of sites where I find that people put --webkit and they don't even put the W3C version of it. --webkit- border radius, and there is no border radius specification. So the best practice is, if you're using vendor prefixes, always put the W3C version of that particular rule last, right? Because if that's how browsers work, right? If you have a particular rule appearing multiple times, redundant specification of particular rule, the last one wins, right? Whichever is specified last, that kind of overrides your previous specifications. So always make sure that you put the W3C name last, right? So the appeal is, make sure you put all browser vendor prefixes, right? So if you're using CSS3 transitions, put --ms-webkit-moz-o-o- is for Opera, that's it, WebKit versus Safari and Chrome. So make sure you put for all browsers. Otherwise, what happens is, the browser that you do choose to support becomes the standard, right? Becomes a pseudo standard. In fact, Microsoft and Firefox, Mozilla had recently, probably a couple of months back, made a proposal in W3C that they're going to start recognizing --webkit in IE and Firefox. You don't want that to happen, right? We've been there. We've lived through those days where a particular browser became pseudo standard, and everybody, started implementing their browser so that it works like that browser. You guys know what I'm talking about? IE6, right? IE6 became a pseudo standard because Firefox, if it has to remain competitive, they have to do what IE6 does, even if it is counter to the W3C spec, right? Because everybody built to IE6. Now we don't want Chrome to become the new IE6, right? So So that's just an appeal to that community to, you know, just adopt, and that gives you a good experience as well, right? So folks who come on other browsers get to see get the same rich experience as well. So you don't lose. So with that little yarn, I thought I'd quickly talk about polyfills and shims. So I know this sounds like a you know, fancy term. This is what the problem that it tries to solve, right? So there is this swanky new feature in your browser, right? And we are really happy, you know, we want to implement it. But then along comes old browsers, and things go nuclear. So what do polyfills do? Polyfills are basically simple libraries, right? They could be JavaScript libraries that provide support for a particular W3C spec. And give you a, you know, basically provide support for that in old browsers. The fidelity of the user experience may not be exactly the same. The best is if the browser supports that spec natively, right? But in case the browser does not support it, polyfills, you know, backfill that. It's called polymorphic backfilling, which sounds even more scary. So the idea is you get to leverage new specs like Canvas in your app, and you still get to not lose your user base who are on older browsers. Shims are similar to polyfills. Only thing shim is a library. Typically, a polyfill typically will implement a W3C spec, right? So if there is a specification for WebSockets, there might be a polyfill which implements that API completely in your library, right? So you get to write code to that spec and not worry about whether the browser supports that particular feature or not. So I can write WebSockets code and not worry about whether the browser supports WebSockets. So in older clients, the polyfill would probably use Flash or probably use Silverlight to provide that, to supplement that, you know, that functionality. But you get to write the same code, right? You don't have to write different code. Shims are typically libraries which tend to be a somewhat higher level abstraction on top of some feature. For example, there is this shim called as Amplify Store, which is a JavaScript, AmplifyJS is a JavaScript library. There is a piece called Store in it, which provides client-side storage capabilities. Right? There are multiple client-side storage options. In fact, my next talk is going to cover that, like DOM storage, IndexedDB. So basically, Amplify Store is an API which is built on top of that. Right? So it'll use whatever is available. So if DOM storage is available, it'll use that. If IndexedDB is available, it'll use that. But it has its own API. It's not a W3C API. Right? So that's what, you know, we mean when we say shims. So you can go to that particular URL. This is a GitHub page maintained by the folks who wrote Modernizer. They maintain this gigantic list of polyfills and shims that are available for major, you know, W3C specifications. So bit.ly/polyfills. So like any open, most of these tend to be open source. Like any open source project that you use, remember to vet the code. So you probably have to, you know, do the QA yourself. You may have to support it in the future. So the standard caveats apply, right? So whenever you use a polyfill and a shim. So I just wanted to show a quick demo of what that might look like. Alright, so this is basically a simple page that I put together, which allows you to doodle on the page, right? So this particular area here is a canvas, HTML5 canvas tag. So I can just go ahead and, you know, do that. I can draw. You can see that there's no plugins, it's just a canvas. Now let's see what happens if I use an older version of the browser. Let's say I go to Internet Explorer 7. So IE7 definitely does not support Canvas. So, you know, So it turns out I can still, you know, draw on this. And this is running in IE7 mode, right? So how does this work? If I right click, you can see that now I'm using Silverlight, right? In the earlier case, that was using native support for Canvas. So how is this thing put together? So if you look at the markup here, I have a canvas tag and I have a the Silverlight object tag here for instantiating the Silverlight plugin. And then I use a little bit of script at the top to figure out which implementation to use. So in fact, I use Modernizer here to detect whether the browser supports canvas, and if it does support canvas, then I use the canvas tag. Otherwise, I use the Silverlight version, and this plugin I got from that, you know, that location, the bit.ly/polyfills. Let me show you what the code for this looks like, right? So there's a fairly intricate stuff over here. But I just want to show you the core drawing routine. So it's not much, right? I'm just drawing lines. So this code here is completely, you know, the canvas API, right? I get the 2D context, I set the stroke style, begin path, move to line 2, and then draw the line, right? Now this is completely independent of what is being used, right? If it's the canvas tag, this will work, obviously. If it is a Silverlight component, this still works. Now the reason is because that's a polyfill, right? They've implemented the canvas API on top of the Silverlight plugin. So that's what you get. And the browser specific code is essentially, you know, just for example, this is the only method where I have kind of abstracted that away. So I have a getCanvas method where I check that. So if canvas is available, then I return a reference to the canvas object. If canvas is not available, then I basically return a reference to the Silverlight canvas instance. The rest of my code in that docker.js, nothing changes, right? It's exactly the same. So that's the benefit of using polyfills, right? So you get to use new specs and not worry about older browsers, or at least not worry about too much. Yes.
So the polyfill can program quite quickly. It doesn't ship out of the box. It doesn't
ship out of the box. Yes, I mean in this case the polyfill I picked from that site.
Right. But so it's manually programmed.
Manually programmed. Correct. It's some individual out of the largeness of their heart they implemented it. Maybe just using it. If we have time, I can talk about video and what is the story about compatibility for HTML5 video. Or if we have questions, we can take that up. I think we have another 12 minutes to go. Do we have questions? Yes. So the question is are there polyfills available for CSS? Okay, so do we have polyfills available for every single CSS3 option? And if yes, what was the second part of the question?
Why don't we use CSS3?
See, for CSS3 the story is slightly different, right? Like I was saying earlier, it really depends on how critical a particular CSS3 feature that you're using in a web app is to your app. Now, see, for example, let's take you're creating a website for somebody, right? And you have a logo right at the top right corner. Would you say that the logo is a critical piece of that site? It absolutely is, right? Your client doesn't see the logo on i8, they're not going to be happy. Now, let's say you use Canvas there for that. First of all, that's probably a bad design choice. Just probably have used an image or something. But in that case, you absolutely have to go the extra mile to make sure that the thing shows up, right? On the other hand, if you have border radius and box shadow, it's completely fine if folks don't see it. So it really depends on the criticality, right? If a particular CSS3 is absolutely critical to your site, your mileage may vary. I mean, depending on what you're trying to use. Let's say you're using CSS3 3D transforms. You know, you probably will not find a polyfill for that, right? On the other hand, for border radius, probably you will. Or for opacity, you will, right? So it really is a case-by-case basis. But in general, I would suggest that, you know, don't worry about it. Go ahead and use all these CSS3 vendor prefixes for your site and, you know, provide that experience. Make sure that it gracefully degrades for older guys, right? So that it's not completely unusable, right? As if it's a lesser, less richer experience, that's totally okay.
What about, sorry?
So the question is, we talked about CSS3, what about HTML5 specs, like geolocation or WebSockets or IndexedDB? So for those we do, you know, you'll probably have better luck finding polyfills. So that particular page that I was referring to has a huge list of polyfills that you can, you know, pretty much for everything that you can imagine. So yes, there are good polyfills available for a vast chunk of the HTML5 specs. Yes.
So in the Acme page example that you showed us,
yes.
When you fell back on the IE7 document, it can script out those types of things because the tags are in there.
Correct.
So is it safe to assume that you've written your CSS on a tag, and a tag that you like, where your selector's tag basically? Where your selector's tag basically goes, like when you use something like section to tag.
So the question is, I think this is, I'm not confused, maybe you can be a bit.
Yeah. So if you're using tag-based selectors, then would it help if you use class-based selectors?
Okay, so the question is, in the example where I had used semantic tags and then tried to style it in CSS, we found that with IE7, without the modernizer include, it looked pathetic. Now, in that case, I think I used IE-based selectors. It wouldn't have made a difference. The question was, would it have made a difference if I had specified a class and then applied the class to the tag? Would IE6 and 8 have better luck with it? It would not.
I have a question. That being said, what's the performance of modernizer on very large
HTML documents? See, modernizer itself doesn't do a whole lot. In the sense that all it does is, when you load the page, all it will do is it will try to do feature detection for a vast chunk of features. In fact, the latest revision of modernizer, you can get just what you want. So for example, I'm not interested in finding out whether the browser supports CSS3 quantities. I don't even use CSS3 quantities. So why should modernizer try to find out if it supports? So that particular page where you can download, you can customize the modernizer download based on a bunch of checkboxes, which say which features you want to sniff, and then you get a customized JS file which sniffs only those features. So that's all it does. It just sniffs and initializes a bunch of properties for instance if it's true if it is supported or false if it's not. The semantic stuff, you don't need to worry about. All it will do is document or create element for all the bunch of semantic tags, probably 20-30 tags. That's nothing. Yes?
Just support for mobile browsers.
Modernizer. Question is, does modernizer support mobile browsers? Yes, it does. Yes.
I just wanted to know whether it's a good practice for all of you to use body page in IE.
The question is it a good idea to support, you know, to use polyfills to support older browsers, because people then get the feature in the older browsers they'll never want to upgrade.
Yeah, maybe a good reason not to support polyfills.
It really depends, right? It's really critical to your app, then you do it. But then it's generally not a good thing to put a website that says this looks best on IE blah version or Chrome blah version. So polyfills gets you around that problem. See, older guys, they still get some experience, it won't be the same experience. For example, if I have canvas with Silverlight, there are problems. The user might not have Silverlight installed, or they might not have the correct version of Silverlight installed, right? And then they have to go to, there's a different experience. It takes you out of the site, you have to go and download the plugin, and it's not the same thing. So, but still, they're not dead in the water, right? That's.
Because even a lot of these polyfills are quite late, and there are 200.
Yes. So the observation was polyfills can be really big, depending on what the feature in question is. For example, Canvas API is pretty big. Usually, they just forward to the Silverlight or the Flash implementation. But still, that overhead is there. Maybe then you can use something like resource loaders, which allow you to conditionally load script and CSS. Yes, yfnode.js is a very popular JS file, so you can use that so that folks who are on a modern browser don't pay for the polyfill, right? Have you done that? Yeah, good point. Any other questions? We have another 6 minutes, or probably 1 minute. Yeah, fine. Do you guys want to talk about video briefly?
Yeah, sure.
So, with HTML5, another interesting thing, or probably the most visible part of HTML5 is the support for video and audio. Right? Everybody says, HTML5, oh, now you can do videos without Silverlight and Flash. So that's great, right? So this is how we used to do video before. And that's what we do. That's what it looks like with HTML5. Much less code. I can put it on a slide. Now, that sounds too good to be true. And turns out it is too good to be true. The sad story is the codec story. It turns out there are different codecs. Right? So video is always compressed, right? You won't be uncompressed video will probably be a 5 minute video will probably be 500 megs. So everything gets compressed. Now the question is, how do you compress it? There are different standards for it. So Internet Explorer and Safari, both on Mac and on iOS devices, they support H.264. H.264 is a very popular video codec. It's a very high quality video codec, but it's a codec which has patent issues, or there are royalties. So if you're using H.264 in a product, you need to pay somebody some money. So Firefox, on principle, so far have supported Theora as the video codec. So if you have a video which is encoded in H.264, it will not play in Firefox. And recently, just last week, probably a couple of weeks back, they made an announcement that Firefox is going to start supporting HTTP code as well. So this is actually probably, you know, very similar to the pseudo standard case, right? Firefox has started adopting something simply because it's really popular, right? Which is unfortunate because there is no consensus around codec. Chrome, you know, they want to go ahead and use WebM as the video codec of choice. They have threatened to drop support for H.264, but they haven't done that till this point. But the official position of Chrome is use WebM for your video, don't use any codec. Unfortunately, WebM is supported only on I think Firefox and Chrome. So, you know, so this is great. All these browser vendors are having a fight. What do we do, right? What do we do so that our videos work across different devices? You support everybody. We've been there, right? That's what we do anyway. Day in, day out, we support everybody. So this is what, but fortunately the W3C spec, I think they had the vision to provide this capability. So if you have video tag, you can specify the source multiple times. So you can provide a source child tag, and here the same video is specified as MP4, OGG, and WebM, which are basically H.264, OGG, and WebM codecs. And the browser will simply pick whatever it understands. But what about old browsers, right? Now we are talking about HTML5 here. We are not talking about, we are talking about the video tag, right? So you fall back to Silverlight and Flash. So this is kind of funny, you know, like the levels of fallback that we do, right? You know, sometimes when I look at code like this, it's like the Inception movie. There's a dream, and inside that dream, there's a dream inside it. So here, if you think about this, you have the video tag, and here this is the video source, and you have to give that multiple times for different browser brands, and then there could be folks who don't know about video, so we give object tag, which could be Silverlight or Flash, and then they might not have Silverlight or Flash. So object tag can have more stuff in the middle here to provide fallback for folks who don't have that, right? So what fallback would you give for folks who don't have that? You put a div here that says get a nice browser. So we have 2 minutes, so maybe I'll quickly show a demo of this. So this is basically a page where I have a HTML5 video. If I do view source, you know, there's nothing fancy going on. I just have a video SRC is that. Now, what I'm going to do is launch Firefox here, and I go open that page, and you know, that's probably not what we expect. This is a video tag, and Firefox has supported the video tag for a very long time, right? So what's the problem? The problem is this is H.264 video. This is, and Firefox likes OGG. So I have another page here, and I go ahead and load here. And of course now Firefox is able to work with that. And all I have done here is basically I have the OGV as well, right? Now that's great, but what about older browsers? So let's say I open this here. Here. So this we know it works fine. So I use my debugging tools and go to IE7, and that's what that looks like, right? That doesn't look like a video. So for that, you know, we do something like that. So this works in IE7 mode, and the reason why that works is because, so here I have my source tags for IE and Firefox, Safari and Firefox, and then I have the object tag for the Silverlight plugin. So that video that you saw here was basically Silverlight plugin. So that's the, you know, that's the story with regard to video, right? And same thing applies to audio as well. So here are some resources that I'll probably leave you with. So these are some interesting books. Introducing HTML5 kind of gives you a well-rounded view of HTML5. Like basically HTML5 is not all the hype. Right. So this is from a publishing firm called as A Book Apart. So they are generally they put really good high quality books about web development. CSS3 for Web Design is also from A Book Apart. In fact, much of the content that I took for the session was from these two books. The nice thing about Introducing HTML5 is that it's a really small book. You can read it quickly. So they tend to be very brief and focused, right? So that's my blog, email, and Twitter handle. So that's about it. Thank you for the session. If you have more questions, I'll hang around if you come and talk to me.